the fall, a couple of years ago, we went through Acts and kind of went a little bit more verse by verse. I'm trying to hit the highlights of the life of Paul and be captivated by his dedicated discipleship and living for Jesus. And kind of be inspired by him and his actions, his plans, and see all those kind of things. Obviously, God's Son is the most important one in the Bible. We have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John written about the life of Jesus. But Paul would really be probably number two, not at all to do with the Godhead, but taking the life of Jesus and spreading it into all the world, serving as an example for us to take the good news out as well. Paul wrote a large part of the New Testament, and which makes me think some people feel that Paul wrote Hebrews. Personally, I don't know who wrote Hebrews, but I think we may use Hebrews at the very end, kind of a tail end to talk about it. But it would probably be maybe even along about this time that some would say the book of Hebrews was written. So if that is one of them. But a large part of the letters of the New Testament written by the Apostle Paul. So just think of the impact that he had. And early on, he was very much a missionary. Secondly, he got to where he started writing letters and writing ministry or ministry that you can send out and broadcast is an important part. And whether it's taking literature to other countries or whether it's a satellite, whatever it might be, that's an important part. And then we see Paul in his later years developing leaders, reproducing leaders. And the wisdom he gave there to like Timothy and Titus and a number of other people certainly took people with him on that, on the first three missionary journeys. And then some of the books that he wrote, he co-authored with other people, written, inspired by the Holy Spirit. So anyway, all of that. And then we come to this end of the third missionary journey. He went back to Jerusalem. He gets arrested, as we looked at last week. And so we're going to pick up with that. He talked about Gentiles, and the people just came unglued. I'm sure there's some kind of expression you could talk about that would help you get the feeling for what's going on here. But they were very upset. It almost reminds me, or it does remind me, very similar to the end of Jesus' life, where the religious people and the political people and the powers that be really struggle with all of this. They have things they want to accomplish on both sides. And we know in Jesus' case, he was the victim of those desires that they had. And it cost him his life. But that was also God's plan, so that he would die for us. And the Apostle Paul was going to be arrested, and he wanted to take the gospel to Rome. And God said, okay, but your flight is going to be delayed, and it's going to be at a different route than you had planned. And so in some ways, it's almost like a fourth missionary journey to Rome. And he gets to spend a couple of years in Caesarea in prison before going to Rome. So anyway, I'm giving you the big picture. Let's get down to the more details, and we're going to be looking at Acts 22, verse 22 through 29, and Frank is going to read that for us, so I want you to kind of listen and think and see what's going on here.
And I'm going to start with the last sentence of verse 21. It says, for I will send you forth from here to the Gentiles. Now, verse 22, and they listened to him until this word. And then they raised their voice and said, away with such a fellow from the earth, for he is not fit to live. Then as they cried out and tore off their clothes and threw dust into the air, the commander ordered him to be brought into the barracks and said that he should be examined under scourging so that he might know what wouldn't know why they shouted so against him. And as they bound him with thongs, Paul said to the centurion who stood by, "Is it lawful for you to scourge a man who is in Rome and uncondemned?" When the centurion heard that, he went and told the commander, saying, "Take care of what you do, for this man is a Roman." Then the commander came and said to him, "Tell me, are you a Roman?" He said, "Yes." The commander answered, "With a large sum I obtained this citizenship." And Paul said, "But I was born a citizen." Then immediately those who were about to examine him withdrew from him, and the commander was also afraid after he found out that he was a Roman and because he had bound him.
All right. Well, sometimes things are settled like the Wild Wild West. Sometimes there's laws involved and processes that are important. And that's the situation we have here. The religious people kind of wanted to settle it their own way. And they got Rome involved. And this commander orders Paul to be taken to the barracks. And they're going to dust him up a little bit. Try to teach him a lesson. And Paul pulls out his Roman citizenship card and kind of flashed it and said, he just asked a question, "What are you going to do?" He asked the man is a Roman citizen. And of course, whenever they find out he's a Roman citizen, they realize, wow, we better go by the law. We better go by the legal process or we're going to be in bigger trouble than what we're giving Paul. And people got a little bit nervous and withdrew, and they were scared. They were alarmed. They were more fearful than a lawsuit. They were thinking this could cost us our lives. So anyway, kind of a wake-up call for all of them. But they thought that flogging him and interrogating him and punishing him would be kind of something that would get him to change his mind. Maybe they could get him to say why the crowd was mad at him and all of that. And obviously, this was God's plan. Also, the wisdom of the Apostle Paul to say, "I think I better appeal to the fact that I'm a citizen." And some of those people, as he says, well, I had to pay for my citizenship. I had to buy it. It cost a lot of money. And Paul wants to emphasize, well, I was born a citizen. And I think that even scared them more. Well, as we think about Paul, we all go through some difficulties sometimes. Sometimes we're probably grateful for the police. We're probably thankful for laws. We're thankful for the freedom we have in America to speak. And we're able to use those laws and things sometimes. And other times, maybe it's God working in a way we don't even realize. It's not a pleasant way, but it's a way that God is at work. Fred?
When you look at the introduction to both Luke and Acts, when Luke is addressing most right, most excellent Theophilus, gives you an idea. This whole thing was written to some Roman official to show Christianity was not a threat to Rome. And I think that's a big part of throughout those books to show that it's not against Rome. Rome is not the enemy. No, the Jewish hierarchy was. But the making point is, Joe, Rome is not our enemy.
Yeah, Rome was very much a system of law. And as long as the Jews kept their nose clean and treated people right, they were kind of going to stay out of it, kind of separation of church and state, so to speak, or religion and political involvement there. So very good. Yeah, the overall book, written for that reason, and so hopefully some Roman people hear some Luke put all of this together so it would be kind of a legal defense in some way. ways, or at least a good understanding of what Paul was about. Because probably the Roman reporter was going to go down in history as saying Paul was this rebel rouser that caused a lot of people trouble, and Luke clarifies that. Yes.
You know, I think sometimes in the world today that we minimize citizenship, and citizenship is very important. I mean, we're all citizens of the kingdom now, and we should celebrate that, and that entitles us to live forever. Our citizenship in whatever city, town, or state and country, it should be important to everyone. And, you know, I think a lot of times it's minimized now. But this is important to Paul. Mm-hmm. It should be important to us, too.
Right. Yes, Dale?
This is really a unique law, to think that a Roman citizen could not be bound and flogged without due course.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that, it was unique.
Yeah, he's saying it's a unique law that as a Roman citizen, you were protected and a really good privilege to have. God picked the right guy to be this missionary to the Gentiles, which is amazing to me how all things came together in the right way.
Kevin.
Yes.
When I was in Europe, when I was 19, as a long time ago, we all felt that the fact that we were Americans protected us.
Yeah.
That no matter what country we were in, we were Americans.
Mm-hmm.
And our country would get us out of trouble.
Yeah.
Not today. But it did happen back then.
Right.
It did.
Yeah, American citizenship meant a lot more.
Yeah.
So very good. Let's go to the next section. Ken Hollingsworth is going to read that for us. Verse 30 of chapter 22 down to chapter 23, verse 11.
The commander wanted to find out exactly why Paul was being accused by the Jews. So the next day he released him and ordered the chief priest and all the members of the Sanhedrin to assemble. Then he brought Paul and had him stand before them. Paul looked straight at the Sanhedrin and said, "My brothers, I have failed my duty to God in all good conscience to this day." At this, the high priest, Annas, ordered those standing near Paul to strike him on the mouth. Then Paul said to him, "God strike you, you whitewashed wall. You stand there to judge me according to the law, yet you yourself violate the law by commanding that I be struck." Those who were standing near Paul said, "How dare you insult God's high priest?" Paul replied, "Brothers, I did not realize he was the high priest, for it is written, 'Do not speak evil about the ruler of your people.'" Then Paul, knowing that some of them were Sadducees and others Pharisees, cried out to the Sanhedrin, "Brothers, I am a Pharisee, descended from Pharisees. I stand on trial because of the hope of the resurrection of the dead." When he said this, a dispute broke out between the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and the assembly was divided. The Sadducees say that there is no resurrection, and that there are neither angels nor spirits, but the Pharisees believe all these things. There was a great uproar. Some of the teachers of the law who were Pharisees stood up and argued vigorously. "We find nothing wrong with this man," they say. "What if a spirit or an angel had spoken to him?" The dispute became so violent that the commander was afraid Paul would be torn to pieces by them. He ordered the troops to go down and take him away from them by force and bring him into the barracks. The following night, the Lord stood near Paul and said, "Take courage. As you have testified about me in Jerusalem, So you must now testify in Rome.
All right. So the Jewish leaders get involved in this again. The Sanhedrin. And Paul, so smart and educated, knew about all the, knew the way they thought. So in his little evangelism school, he tries to identify and connect with some of them. But in the midst of all of their great power, he thinks, he figures out, you know, I could preach some truth here and divide them, and they take the heat. And him fly a little below the radar. So he brings up this concept of the hope of the resurrection. And because of that, the Sadducees and the Pharisees looked at the resurrection differently. So they started arguing among themselves, which took away Paul being the focus of attention. And they got more upset, and they wanted to... It said they went, the commander was afraid that Paul would be torn to pieces by them. So he calls him back into the barracks and takes care of him. And he gets a little encouragement from God. You're going to get to go to Rome. So you're going to get out of town alive, okay? I've got future plans for you. So you're going to be okay no matter what happens here. But he is very much trying to encourage Paul. And let him know that he has a greater mission and purpose for him, that he is not done with him. It's interesting to me that Paul struck the high priest on, well, they ordered Paul be struck on the mouth, and then Paul kind of talks back a little bit, and the person standing near Paul says, "How dare you insult God's high priest?" What's interesting to me was that Paul didn't realize that he was the high priest.
Weren't they supposed to wear a particular garb?
I would have thought so. I'm not sure what's going on there that Paul didn't realize it. But you do see Paul immediately apologizes, which is the, I think, probably the Christian thing to do is to quote some scripture.
And he wasn't feeling the role of
God. Yeah.
Maybe he didn't look at that.
Evidently, a lot of them at that time were a little hypocritical and corrupt, and so maybe rightfully so, his actions didn't match his responsibility. But he does apologize in the way that he quotes scripture. He said, "Do not speak evil about the ruler of your people." So. He does say, "I didn't realize that's who you were." So that's a good thing on his part.
Well, I'm surprised they didn't take exception with the word God's high priest.
You're surprised that... Say that again.
I'm surprised that he didn't take exception with the fact that it's God's high priest, because we're under a new law now.
Yeah.
And Jesus divine.
And obviously... I think he was doing what God wanted him to. But he does give the high priest a little grief, doesn't he?
Question.
Yes.
I've never heard anyone call a whitewashed wall.
You never heard anyone call that?
No.
You know, Jesus talked about the whitewashed tombs. It's kind of a phrase talking about hypocrisy. A figure of speech implying hypocrisy. So,
it's like you put on you put on a show of faith. In other words, you act like you're something and you're really not what you act like.
Yeah.
And so he says, you know, that these guys were like five or two. In other words, the tomb looks beautiful on the outside. The inside is for dead bones.
Yeah.
And so, the inside, the rotten parts, doesn't show because of the outside. Okay, so they were appearing to be something, but they really weren't that.
Mm-hmm.
is what I get from that.
It's quite interesting to me, too. Remember, last week we talked about this was probably the 25th anniversary of Pentecost from the original beginning of the church to this point. We don't get the indication that Paul gets to go to stay there for Pentecost because they're going to move it, but you would think these people would be on their best behavior, but they're trying to squelch Paul so much that they're willing to do anything to be able to get through it. Jerry?
Well, we didn't remember what set this high priest off. It's the same thing that set off Bob when he said, I'm going, you know, I've been told to go to the Gentiles. That just put them in a rage.
Yeah.
And when he says, I've lived all in good conscience before God. They know what he was before he was converted. And they didn't approve of his conversion.
Right.
So this guy's living, to them, Paul's living a hypocritical life.
Mm-hmm.
And you dare say that you're in good conscience, you're in good standing with God? And that's close, I would think, to the high priest, this is close to blasphemy.
Yeah.
And I mean, it just sets them off just like that.
And there's a little bit of irony in the thought that they think he's hypocritical.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, pop called kettle black.
Yeah.
I think whitewash just kind of refers to your only surface clean. You know, and underneath it, you're still got all the rot stuff. You put a little whitewash on a wall, and it looks surface clean.
We've all bought one of those houses, haven't we?
Yeah.
I was so excited. I bought a little Datsun pickup one time. I saw it was white. Had looked like just a little bit of rust on it. I took it to the car wash, and woo, it was full of rust. It was done after that.
Wisconsin.
Yeah, exactly. It was Fond du Lac, Wisconsin. That was it. Wiley, would you read chapter 23, verse 12 through down to 22?
Yes.
Okay. This gray-haired guy right here.
The next morning, some Jews formed a conspiracy and bound themselves with an oath not to eat or drink until they had killed Paul. More than 40 men were involved in this plot. They went to the chief priests and the elders and said, "We have taken a solemn oath to eat, not to eat anything until we have killed Paul. Now then, you and the Sanhedrin petition the commander to bring him before you on the pretext of wanting more accurate information about his case. We are ready to kill him before he gets here." But when the son of Paul's sister heard of this plot, he went to the barracks and told Paul. Then Paul called one of the centurions and said, "Take this young man to the commander. He has something to tell him." So he took him to the commander. The centurion said, "Paul, the prisoner sent for me and asked me to bring this young man to you because he has something to tell you." And the commander took the young man by the hand, drew him aside, and asked, "What is it that you want to tell me?" And he said, "Some Jews have agreed to ask you to bring Paul before the Sanhedrin tomorrow on the pretext of wanting more accurate information about him. Don't give in to them, because more than 40 of them are waiting in ambush for him. They have taken an oath not to eat or drink until they have killed him. They are ready now, waiting for your consent to their request." The commander dismissed the young man with this warning: "Don't tell anyone you have reported this to me."
Okay. Interesting, isn't it? Sometimes people's motives are not the best in the world. And Paul's nephew, the son of Paul's sister, came and reported. And the scriptures make it very clear that there was this pretext this mindset before they go and get Paul, that they want him to come out. And they are devoted. They've got this vow. They've taken an oath not to eat or drink until Paul is killed. They must have died before him if they kept that vow. But because God was protecting him. And they were not able to accomplish what they wanted to there anyway. And they moved on. Let me just summarize this last section. Paul is transferred to Caesarea, where I don't think it says at the end of here, but later on it says he spent 2 years there in prison. And he's kind of kept there for a while, and important political officials come in and interview him and try to figure out what's going on. And it's about like our courts today, it seems like. You're in jail for a long time and in and out of court and appeals, and eventually things aren't resolved and you're passed on to somebody else and that type of thing. And that's kind of what Paul is going to go through. Some believe that Paul wrote the book of Colossians, I believe, during this imprisonment. I don't know if that's true or not, but at least a thought. He spent a couple of years there and interviewing a lot of high officials and making a difference there and eventually being let go. And the old clock on the wall says stop, so we're going to stop and pray, and Andy's going to come and lead us in prayer, so...
I am thine, O Lord, I have heard thy voice and told thy love to me. But I long to rise in the arms of faith and be closer drawn to thee. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer. Nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious sleeping time. Consecrate me, Lord, to thy service, Lord, by the power of the great divine. Let my soul look up with the steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious sleeping time. There are depths of love that I can't. Till I cross the narrow sea, there are heights of joy that I may not reach, till I rest in peace with thee. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious sleeping
time. Number 78.
Can you count the stars of evening that are shining in the sky? Can you count the clouds that daily over all the world go by? God the Lord doth not slumber, keepeth all the countless number, but he careth more for thee, but he careth more for thee. Can you count the birds that warble in the sunshine of the day? Can you count the little fishes that in sparkling waters play? Come the Lord there, numbers known, for each one his very soul. Shall he not remember thee? Shall he not remember thee? Can you count the many children in the who is now the sorrow, rise again and morning light. God the Lord, bless in heaven, loving care to each has given. He has not forgotten thee. He has not forgotten me.
Number 69. Beautiful out somewhere. So if you look at the second staff, second verse, next to the last word, how do you say that?
Girdon.
Girdon? 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 All right, very good. Get an A for pronunciation. What does it mean? Thank you. Very good. Teacher over here. What is it? Oh, is it on the bottom? See, you always cheat. Look down. That's what a teacher knows how to do. You're right. It means reward. So now when you say it, we might mispronounce it because I'm not for sure we got it right, but we're going to at least know what we're saying. We mean to be saying. And we are looking forward to a beautiful reward someday. Somewhere the sun is shining, somewhere the songbirds well, hush in thy sad repining, God lives and all is well. Somewhere, beautiful Isle of Land of the true, where we live anew, beautiful Isle of somewhere the day is longer, somewhere the task is done, somewhere the heart is stronger, somewhere the somewhere, beautiful Isle